When first I saw this beautiful touchscreen oscilloscope, I wondered if it would have a web browser and a YouTube app. The display would be up to the task, but the developers have invested their time into much more reasonable functions. A few months ago, I had a sudden influx of repair jobs that needed a logic analyzer. Like this old, semi-professional Canon video camera, which seemed to have a problem on an 8-channel DC to DC converter. A Zoom H4n audio recorder, which didn't make it through the boot process. I suspect that only half a firmware was written to its memory chip. And a historic computer synthesizer system that has been waiting for its consultation with a logic analyzer for years. So I thought it was high time to get one. Quite unusually, none of my Chinese friends wanted to send me one. But one of the most prestigious test gear companies in the world, Rohde & Schwarz, very kindly provided a demo unit of their RTB2004 oscilloscope. It came in this beautiful embroidered douchebag bag, but I don't think that's included in the normal retail package. But then, neither is an expiring software option. Which reminds me of the sad day on which I'll have to give it back. Before that, I wanted to make one more YouTube video with it. One that doesn't seem to exist yet. A compact one. But now we are already 2 minutes into this compact video and nothing has been said or done yet, so let's get going. It boots very fast and is pleasantly quiet. I love the large high-resolution display. But even after months, I'm still not convinced by the touchscreen. I mean, it's an advantage for menu navigation and it probably doesn't cost that much to implement it. But I would never use gestures to manipulate the displayed waveforms. It's just too arbitrary. Luckily, I don't have to. The rotary encoders are perfectly fine. There's a lot of useful software built into this thing. And the fact that I'm able to operate it without ever looking at the manual is a huge accomplishment by the software developers. There is sort of an app drawer, which has shortcuts to some of the most useful features. Nice idea, but it could be so much more. For starters, I'd like to see a few more apps, maybe even user-programmable ones. That would be revolutionary. Just as revolutionary as this browser-based remote control already is. It's basically running a web server and live streaming the display data. That's a fantastic tool for documentation, teaching, and YouTube videos. Because I no longer have to position a camera in front of the scope, I can just screen capture a browser window instead. That alone is my favorite feature, but it gets even better. If you want it, you can have the full interactive user interface to go along with your live stream. That way you can control your oscilloscope from far away or even over the internet. Thank goodness they didn't market this as an Internet of Things oscilloscope. But since I've mentioned the keyword now, we might as well have another look at this LoRaWAN gateway. Because I'm in Germany, it is configured to communicate at around 868 MHz. And thanks to the RTB2004's generous sample rate of 2.5 gigasamples per second, it should be possible to see the signal in the frequency domain using the FFT function. I'll set the center frequency to 868 MHz and then I'll try to catch the signal manually. With a special antenna suitable for this band, it's right there, clearly visible. With the 2.4 GHz Wi-Fi antenna, there's almost nothing left of the signal. Which is not surprising, but a good way to demonstrate the FFT capabilities of the scope. Another noteworthy capability comes with the custom 10-bit ADCs they are using. A high effective vertical resolution. Meaning that small signals are not hidden within the instrument's own noise and are still visible on top of larger signals. That makes it ideal for power supply measurements. And I just so happen to have these weird bipolar 35-volt switching power supplies. I would like to use those in my next project, but for that they need to have reasonably low noise outputs even under load. Let's have a look. I would have really liked to avoid building an electronic load for this, but it seems like this small power resistor can't quite handle the 270 watt I'm putting into it. Plop. Who would have thought? For some reason, this carefully assembled glass of water and resistance wire drew way too much current, even though the resistance was correct. I was aiming for 10 ampere, which a 500 watt power supply should be able to deliver. I guess there's no way around a makeshift electronic load. I made one real quick, based on a Mitsubishi power pack and the current shunt that's built into this dual panel meter. Plop. Come on, it wasn't my fault this time. Now, with a much more gentle load, I'll set coupling to AC, because I have little interest in the DC voltage portion, and then I can use the quick measure function to measure and display all of the interesting parameters automatically. Especially around switching power supplies, it's important to use a ground spring to pick up as little extra noise as possible. Well, the output voltage noise of over 200 mV peak-to-peak, as measured directly on the output capacitor, is way too high. I might have to look for another power supply. I'd also prefer one with a failure mode other than a circuit breaker triggering explosion. But that's just a matter of personal preference. I'll cover that again in the next video. For now, back to the feature that started it all. I've been talking about replacing this faded Keithley 2001 VFD for a while now, and I may have just found a perfectly shaped OLED display for that purpose. The only thing that's left to do is to make a translator that listens to the existing UART front panel communication and just displays characters and symbols accordingly. A logic analyzer is a very useful tool for such a project. I'm no logic analyzer expert, but I've got to say that this one feels fantastic. It's probably the one feature that benefits the most from the large display area. Maybe not in this example, because it's just super simple UART. I can just display the data in ASCII and I'm already getting readable text. But I think that too is worth covering in a separate video. This one was about the Rohde Schwarz RTB2004, which was a pleasure to work with. Easily the best oscilloscope I've ever had. Sadly, I have to give it back soon, but I'd be happy to work with Rohde Schwarz hardware again in the future. Thank you for watching.